Welcome to our symposium, our annual symposium of the Society for the Study of Visual Language UK. We're focusing this year very much on the revolution which has happened since the 19th of December in Sudan. It's a momentous event. It's an unparalleled event, not only in Sudan, not only in Africa or the Arab world, but I think in the world. I think it's a revolution which has been absolutely remarkable by not only its determination and its courage, you do see that in revolutions, of course, in other countries, but also by its absolute peacefulness. I think it's extraordinary. I cannot imagine it happening in such a peaceful way, or any protests happening on that scale, happening in such a peaceful way here, for example. You know, the temptation to violence is very great, and people resisted it incredibly, apart, unfortunately, from some of the army and the rapid support forces, who managed to kill several hundred people, injure many people, and of course we know that, you know, several hundred possibly, certainly dozens, have disappeared, and we don't know where they are. So, you know, I'm sure we're all thinking of that. But we're also thinking about all the people who've disappeared in Sudan over the last half century, first in South Sudan, then in the Nuba Mountains and Blue Nile, and in Darfur, where hundreds of thousands of people, almost entirely civilians in all cases, have been killed by the government, whose overthrow, possible overthrow, we are marking today, we're commemorating today. We did have one planned. We had a speaker who was coming and for family reasons has been unable to come, after all, and is not in this country now. So we did try in that respect, and we hope to remedy that a bit with some of the seminars which we're planning to have in the coming year, say, at SOAS. So we'll notify you of that, and members will get notification, of course, and it will also be on our website. So basically that's really all I want to say at this point, and I want to hand you over to our two vice presidents who would like to introduce themselves. I think they're probably well known to most of you. Very briefly, Fida Mahmoud and Mawan Mortad.
As you were saying, it's Mawan Mortad and Fida Mahmoud. And we are just here to help. If you have any queries at all, please just find one of us. Fida will be presiding over the details. She'll be actually overlooking the time and being. She has a reputation of being extremely, strict with time and ruthless in that way, so that we can all have fruitful and useful debate and discussions today. Thank you very much. Just a reminder, very quickly, about the minutes. So, about the essentials. Really, telephones are absolutely important that we turn those off. We're having lunch at 12:30. So. Probably is not too long, and we aim to finish at 5. So, thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Charlotte, I'm the editor of Sudan Studies, and we're honoured and delighted to have Dr. Amira Osman, who's going to talk to us about the role of the Sudanese diaspora in the UK and also in Sudan. And I'm afraid we're a little bit past time, but we hope that she can speak for 15 to 20 minutes and then we'll have time for questions. Thank you very much.
My presentation is about the role of the Sudanese diaspora in the UK in the 19th December. Some people say 13th of December because that is the first time people went to street. Reflections, challenges, and the way forward. The layout of my presentation, it's about 20 minutes, but I will try to make it in 15 minutes. I will talk about immigration trend in the UK, challenges, coping mechanisms, contributions, and gaps. I will end with the way forward. How many people are we in the UK? There is no a definite statistic. There is no, one statistic on that, but like 40 years ago, 50 years ago, we were handful of people, like 20, maybe people settled in the UK. And then those people were mainly professionals. According to 2001 census in the UK, we were more than 10,000 people, then became almost 20,000 according to the United Nations. That was in 2015. And we are scattered in different cities, big cities like Birmingham, London, Manchester, Newcastle. Those cities are multicultural cities. This trend was mainly professionals, doctors, businessmen, and students. The trend has started to change since the military coup in 1989, where many Sudanese came to the UK seeking asylum to get a refugee status. Then, since that time, we started getting more asylum seekers and then less professionals and students. We also get unaccompanied minors, those who came on their own without their parents. Some are single mothers. People find themselves in unforeseen difficult situations, mainly intended to stay temporarily in the UK, hoping to go back to Sudan. After they said 5 years, 10 years, people end up staying for 30s, 40s. They were not able to go back to Sudan. Then after the comprehensive peace agreement, many headed back home, hoping to stay there and to make their contribution. But many didn't stay, they came back. Why? Maybe you can discuss that later. That could be because what they thought about to get there, they were not able to get it. Many thought that, okay, there's going to be a relative bureaucracy peace, we can settle there, but that wasn't materialized. So they had to come back. Now, is there any possibility for return? Can we go back now? Is there any possibility for return and repatriation? Can this situation be reversed after the revolution? We will talk about that later. In the UK, people are facing many challenges that include language barrier. You know about it. I'm going to go through it quickly. Language barrier, isolation, loneliness, hostile environments towards immigrants in general, especially refugees, asylum seekers, racism at the workplace, school, street, shopping areas. And changes of gender rules and relations. As I just mentioned, some women came with their own, but they came here, they have different environment, different situation. They have to take care of their children, to take them to school, to protect them, to look after them, to be the main breadwinner. That kind of stuff is very difficult and it's challenging. Also, lack of awareness about the culture and laws in this country. Some of us, we don't know the law, we don't know the culture. That's a problem, that's a challenge. Being in the diaspora itself is a challenge. And many are struggling to make a living. No time for politics. This is a very important point because I'm talking about the revolution. Many people felt no time for politics. Some lost hope and believed that the regime wouldn't go, so they didn't want to go to waste their time. For example, protesting in front of the embassy. 20 years ago, seven people go to the embassy and were still there. Some were in a position of indifference. The regime is not going to go, but she was not going to go. It's going to that kind of stuff. Some became disconnected, travel to Sudan was a problem, difficult. We also have generation challenges. We have first generation, those who came as adults. They are more connected to Sudan. We have what the second generation, those who were born here. In between, we have what some scholars call 1.5 generation. Those people came here as children. They are struggling somehow. And I will leave this for the second generation. And the 1.5 generation to talk about it because I think they know it better than everybody. But we perceive these two generations as they don't have sense of belonging, they don't have knowledge of Sudan, they don't have interest in politics. That's our perception about them. Parents are struggling to pass on their culture to their children, and they have many ideas on Sudan because they haven't traveled to Sudan. Some of them were born here, some of them came as children. A blurry idea about Sudan, this idea was mixed with myth, with memory and storytelling. And the media representation. As parents, we tell them Sudan is a very nice country. This country is Africa, green lands, the two nice, and so on. Very nice, color idea. But the media representation, when they open the Al-Jazeera or BBC, focus on Africa, it is Sudan is about war, about desert, that kind of negative stuff. So their idea of Sudan is not that kind of clear idea. We also, this generation were unable to build a strong tie with Sudanese people, community in the UK. You ask your child to go to a Sudanese party, they tell you, oh, that is boring, we are not going, we don't like that, we are not going to go. So that kind of disconnection. Despite that, we're having so many coping mechanisms. We try to keep up with the motherland, like WhatsApp, telephones, our people there. We also try to make social network at the host country here. We go to parties, social events, 8th of March. Sudanese doctors, they have their own social network. We also tried to integrate in the host country, in the UK, by being active in political affairs of the country, and we do some kind of volunteering activities at different places.